Great. Everyone who's coming in, welcome. And just a note that if you want to put in your where you're coming from, your affiliation, and your favorite sustainable business in the chat, we would love to hear it. It gives us a sense of who's here. And you can see we have quite an impressive range of folks from NGOs, from restaurants, from other sustainable businesses, organizations, as well as citizens committed to sustainability. We're going to have a fantastic session, and our moderator is Tiandra. So I'll take it over to you, Tiandra.
Thanks, Leah. Okay, hi again. My name is Tiandra Willingham, and I am a volunteer with the DC chapter of the Sierra Club. And we are excited to welcome you to the Exploring Innovative Takeout Container Solutions webinar. Whew, that's a mouthful. Tonight's event has been organized by the Zero Waste Committee. Okay, so let's get started. If we're going to tame takeout trash, we are going to need to make some changes. We have to rethink the use of disposable plastic and other single-use takeout containers. If you're like me and order takeout almost daily, you will find that your takeout trash can really begin to pile up. So I order restaurants, carryout restaurants. I have a lot of these black containers. I have these plastic containers. I have single-use utensils, and they are piling up. It is a mess. But reusable container services are one of the most important system changes that we need. Instead of using a container one time or storing old containers in your cupboard until you run out of space, takeout containers can be used over and over again without generating trash. Restaurants often don't have time to recover, wash, and sanitize reusable containers. So that's why we're here today, to explore third-party reusable takeout container services. This evening's webinar is going to explore the many ways these services can be organized. We will be hearing from three of the top leaders in this burgeoning industry, and they will be sharing their business model with us tonight. We are so glad you're here. But let's all discuss why the DC chapter is organizing this event. We know that the new DC Zero Waste Omnibus Amendment Act recognizes that restaurants can use reusable takeout container services to fill their orders. We're interested in taming takeout trash in DC and welcoming more of these businesses to launch their services here. That means if you're interested in making contact with our speakers or each other, we invite you to use this event to network. We'll be posting the speakers' emails in the chat so you can contact them after the event. We also want to take your questions. We'll have two rounds with the speakers. We'll take questions for 10 minutes after the first round and 10 minutes after the second round. Speakers will also stay for 15 minutes of overtime if you still have questions. So please put your questions in the chat as the speakers are presenting. We'll try to get to as many of them as possible. We also want you to engage in the chat, ask questions, share your experience, network. We definitely want to make sure that you get as much out of this webinar as possible. So right before I introduce our speakers, we want to conduct a short poll to learn a little bit more about you, our wonderful participants. We have some volunteers, Ike and Alexis. If you could kindly launch the poll, we'll give you guys 40 seconds to respond. It looks like it's up, so here we go. And just as you're completing the poll, just a social media note, if anybody is live tweeting this event, we encourage you to use hashtag taming takeout trash, and it's capital TTT. Okay, we'll give you about 10 more seconds until we close the poll. Five, four, three, two, one. Okay, let's see the results. Oh, nice. Okay, so we have a huge amount of people that selected the option, 65%. I am a customer and want reusable options. That is awesome. Absolutely awesome to hear. And hopefully you'll get a lot from this webinar. It looks like we have a nice chunk of people that wrote other. So we expect for you guys to definitely engage in the chat and kind of let us know what that means. We also have for question two, have you tried a reuse system before? It looks like 18% of you say yes regularly. 61% have said no, not yet. So I hope you get a lot of information and you're encouraged by what you hear today. And hopefully at some point we will get some services here locally and we'll be able to get those numbers up. Everyone can respond yes. And I'm not sure if everyone got to see the results of that poll, but hopefully we can share that with the group.
Yes, they did.
Great. Thank you. Okay, so let's meet our panelists. We have two entrepreneurs who focus on food containers and one who features beverage containers. From Durham, North Carolina, Crystal Dreisbach, founder and executive director, Don't Waste Durham, and inventor Green to Go. Operating in both Boulder and Berkeley, we have Dagny Tucker, founder and CEO of Vessel. And from Minneapolis, Minnesota, Natasha Gaffer, software engineer, co-founder Foreverware. So thank you, Crystal, Dagny, and Natasha for joining us today. I'm going to ask our panelists a round of questions related to their business. We'll give each of you 4 minutes and then open up for a 10-minute Q&A period before coming back with another round of questions. So Crystal, we're gonna start with you. Please describe your business model and tell us how your business works to tame takeout trash.
Sure, let me pull up my slides.
That would be great.
Let me know if you can see that as it comes up. Again, my name's Crystal Dreisbach. I'm the executive director of a nonprofit in Durham, North Carolina called Don't Waste Durham. And I'm gonna talk about the city level reuse models that my organization has been pilot testing, innovating and adapting since 2017. One of those is called Green to Go. And we are a nonprofit, like I said, we've create solutions that prevent trash. That is our mission. And we do that because we obviously want to turn that faucet off right at its source. So we work in both reuse innovations as well as policies around source reduction, because we really believe policy and innovation go hand in hand. And I know the Sierra Club agrees. There's a lot of change. It sounds like amazing groups in Washington, DC, and a lot of legislation coming down the pipeline that will support reuse, which sounds really great. Of course, we know that laws can incentivize people in industry to choose the right behaviors, or they can de-incentivize the less desirable behaviors. Pretty simple. But then at the same time, we also need the innovations that give people in industry alternatives that they can use now. So I'm sure you're all very aware of the problems, but just as a little context for Durham, this is not an issue that's unique to Durham. I bet this is happening a lot in other places where our audience members live. Durham's landfill closed in the mid-90s, and since then it trucks its trash daily on a 200-mile round trip to a landfill in a poor marginalized county. And meanwhile, trash in the streets, of course, creates stormwater management problems, pollution, and the other problem is that compostable food packaging, while it sounds fancy and sounds great, It is costly in comparison, and the overwhelming majority, as we're finding, contained a forever chemical called PFAS, and they end up in the landfill anyway, where, of course, they produce large amounts of methane gas. And we all know recycling has its problems. Their facility's most costly pain point is getting the wrong materials and getting not enough of the right materials. And, you know, financial viability is threatened right now. So a lot of these costs are being passed along to the cities, and we see municipalities enacting bans on single-use items. So what we need to address the issue now are circular reuse models. So I'm going to talk about technology, infrastructure, and supply chain. So right now we have the current supply chain is a relationship with the trash can. And that's just not the way we want to be headed. I can tell from the survey results from everybody on this call. We would like to have a reuse model that is viable and profitable all along the value chain. So we started in 2017 with a reusable takeout container service called Green to Go. And we began with a small pilot. Our program makes reusable a choice where it hasn't been before. We've now added reusable pizza boxes, stainless steel sauce cups with lids, and a catering model called Green to Go Dinner Club. And this summer we're adding coffee cups and bowls. So since then, we are under a nonprofit. Our goal with all of this is really to create a great model and help other cities pilot their own. So we share knowledge, our tools, our software, our best practices, so that, and also problem solving phone calls to help other cities step by step create their own program. So we're always happy to do that. And Dagny and Natasha, my co-panelists here, are also part of the Reuse System Alliance that we all founded together, made up of about 30, 35 reuse companies around the world. And what's really cool is we have a formal agreement between us to share knowledge in coopetition, because we want to help one another, we want to speak as one voice, and we know that if each of our groups does well, the whole reuse movement's going to go well. So that makes us feel really good. And we're also into lots of action. So let me show you how our Green to Go model works. It's very simple. You can start over here on the left with the mobile app. The customer comes into the restaurant, or in this case, as we know with the pandemic, they're ordering online. So they choose to check out a Green to Go container using their app. They get their food in a reusable container. Instead of a disposable, they take it home, enjoy their food, and when they're ready, they can return it to any return station in town. So I'll just pause for a moment. The app is the technology. And of course we have the supply chain of getting these containers to the restaurants, just as any other vendor would with disposables, except we're the reuse vendor. And then part of the infrastructure we built are these return stations. We want to make it very easy and convenient for customers across the city to return, because recovery of the materials, incentivizing recovery of the materials, is pretty much the name of the game. Dagny and Natasha will back me up on this. It's, if you're not recovering the containers, what is the point? So having convenient return stations is just one factor that helps that happen. And then here's a picture of Karen here on her bicycle. She does her routes. She picks up the used containers. She transports them to a central wash facility where she washes, sanitizes, and dries. And then here's Karen again. Oops, restocking. Okay, now I'm completely messed it up. Restocking the restaurants, and the process begins again. So very similar to many reuse systems that you'll hear about. And you know, when I first thought this up back in 2010, I told everybody I could think of, and everybody laughed at me. They said it wouldn't work. But in fact, it is working. I want to say also that one trend, I've been saying this for 10 years, but it's now just in the last year come up a lot, that really having a large scale municipal wash facility is super important. Because if you really think about it, reuse comes down to washing things. It's not rocket science, it's washing dishes. So what we've done is we've upgraded to a larger scale wash facility that can help switch all kinds of businesses off single use. on an even larger scale, basically taking our restaurant model and applying it to other places like schools and sports venues. So we also, in 2019, began a series of tests to see whether the recycling industry could be the existing infrastructure that supports a very large scale shift to reusables. After all, if we want to switch the whole town of Durham off of disposables, how are we going to collect all that stuff? We're going to need a lot more than Karen on a bicycle. So we attached RFID and Bluetooth, we used drones and artificial intelligence, and we did this series of pilot tests to see whether you could recover materials using the recycling infrastructure, sort them off the line, wash, sanitize, and get them back to retailers and manufacturers that need the materials that you're sorting. We also did a value chain analysis to see, is this a financially viable value all around the chain to all parties? And we presented the results of our two pilot tests at the EPA Recycling Innovation Expo and many other conferences, and we're starting pilot number 3 this year. So this has really led to something we think could happen on a bigger scale, because what is something that every city has? It has a recycling infrastructure and technology and facilities already. So we really think the city, and I'm glad so many cities are here, is a great entry point for circular reuse models. And this is really backed up by Ellen MacArthur Foundation research indicating that the single largest source of pollution, single-use pollution, is in cities, and that by 2050, 75% of our population will live in cities and create 50% of the world's trash. So I like to throw out this question: what's the government's responsibility in all this? It's so awesome to see so many great companies, packaging free companies, reuse companies popping up everywhere, but isn't preventing trash also part of any good city's waste management strategies? I think so. And I have some key reasons why I think this should eventually become a municipal utility, because unwittingly or not, the government has actually been subsidizing very pollutive 10-cent styrofoam containers by providing things like municipal trash pickup with no paper throw. People just put it in there, out of sight, out of mind, and we know what happens when that happens. So we want to help incentivize changes in behavior, and we hope to inspire reuse and proliferate reuse systems everywhere.
Thank you, Crystal. You said so much that we probably will need to unpack later. The information you gave was so helpful, and it's so important just to reiterate the fact that, you know, policy, how that can influence behavioral changes. It'll be great, the fact that you told us that you're sharing this information. So you're not just having all this information and keeping it to yourself. You're willing to share this with other businesses so they can learn about this business model. And that is very important. And just so people know, I'm dialed in twice. So this is me, I'm the host, just so you know who's talking. Just wanted to make sure that was clear. So Dagny, you're up next. Can you, if you would like to describe your business model and tell us how your business works to tame takeout trash.
Tiandra, I think Dagny dropped off, so we're waiting for her to join back in, so.
Sure, okay. So, okay, in that case, Natasha.
Okay, let me just share my screen here really quick. And understand where I'm at here. Okay, I am Natasha Gaffer. I'm the CEO and co-founder of Forever Ware. One of my co-founders is also on the call today, Nolan Singroy, and he might be able to answer some of the questions as they pop up. My background is in software engineering, as is the rest of my team. A little bit about me: I'm obsessed with food. I love to talk about traveling and ocean scuba diving, and of course, the topic at hand. And I'd love to chat with some of you after this, so please feel free to reach out to me. At Foreverware, we work directly with food businesses of all types and sizes. So we work with restaurants, grocery stores, we're open to food trucks, farmers markets, event hosts, caterers, you name it. If you're something else, drop it in the chat so we know. When a partner joins our network, we provide container options to get them stocked up. We currently have 7 shapes and sizes, but we've tested about 13 of them. And if you want, you can check out our Instagram page as well to see a few more of the options and what they look like. They're made of 304 stainless steel. This is the same material that your pots and pans and kitchen utensils are made of. And we have both insulated and non-insulated options. And I'm happy to answer some questions about the perks of those in the Q&A. And they last for thousands of uses. They come with a silicone lid that seals nicely and they won't break down in the environment. So here's how our system works for customers. You get to borrow, enjoy, return, and then repeat. So customers order from participating food vendors via the typical means. So online, over the phone, at the counter, dine-in, self-serve, or subscription, or anything else that I missed. And an example would be, I walk into Chipotle, I get to the line, I ask, hey, can I have my burrito bowl and foreverware? When I check out, I pay a $5 refundable deposit per container. And then I enjoy my burrito bowl on the go in a hashtag real bowl. And then I get to return that container later, get my deposit back, or swap for free when I order again. On the business side of things, businesses fulfill, track, sanitize, and then repeat. And had I placed my Chipotle order in online, the order receipt would have prompted the kitchen to fulfill my order in a foreverware container. The front of the house staff would have packed my order for pickup and accepted any returns that I brought back or swapped. And for any containers that were returned, they would get washed and sanitized prior to being used again and again. And then how to get set up. So when you're ready, there's no commitment or risk. Simply fill out the interest form on our website. We have a little section on our website for businesses. Where you can learn about our program. It's foreverware.org. Other things that you'll have to do is you'll have to add reusable packaging options to your point of sale and online menus. We'll deliver locally or ship you a starter kit with a counter display, window sticker, and your first shipment of containers. And then all you have to do is get your staff up to speed. We have some guides to help you do that, and then you're off to the races. So as far as costs go, we charge a monthly membership fee based on actual usage that is similar and sometimes less than the price of disposable alternatives. So that is the cost to the business. It's free for consumers to use. Our deposit is completely refundable. So that's that. And we work with more than just our network businesses. We also work with other types of customers. We work with closed loop systems. So these would be companies that want to buy the containers outright. They don't need any sort of tracking because the containers don't leave the building. These are things like hospitals, grade schools, corporate cafeterias, subscriptions, et cetera. And some of the perks of working with a system like Foreverware is that when you purchase from us, we can help you decide which containers might be the best. We source the containers both locally and offshore at volume prices. We vet our sources, buying from suppliers that are reputable, that we have relationships with. And then we may also stock them locally in our warehouse, so you wouldn't have to wait to get them. And then on the side of the network members, these are members that require some sort of tracking because the containers can be taken home. They're potentially returned to multiple locations, and these would be restaurants, grocery stores, food trucks, farmers markets, et cetera. And there are a bunch of perks to working with us. So we provide the mechanisms for tracking the containers, and we assume the risk if the containers are lost, meaning if the customers don't bring them back. We also distribute and retrieve containers to and from food businesses as they're needed, so you don't need a lot of storage on site. We provide the guidance and technical assistance on how to get your program set up and training for your staff. We replace, repair, and recycle damaged containers for no additional cost or risk. So you don't have to store all these damaged containers waiting for them to get recycled. We just take care of that for you. We also promote you as a partner in our network. We list you on our website and any other place where we can mention you, press releases, et cetera. And then one of the main things about being a network member is convenience for customers. We know through research of recycling that it has to be extremely convenient. So as a part of a network, customers can return their containers to any vendor in the network. And this also increases turnover rates, which mean that we have smaller fleets of containers in our communities. And then the final type of customer we work with are systems like ourselves that want to start their own reuse program and just use someone else's software. We don't offer it yet, but we are working on it.
Okay. Thank you so much, Natasha. That is awesome. That's a great presentation. I see the questions are rolling in. You and Crystal had both mentioned something that I think is a huge deal. It's convenience. So people will use your products or use the services. It has to be convenient for people to buy in, and that's the key thing. I would like to encourage any of the participants, as you have questions, go ahead and post them in the chat. We'll have Q&A shortly. We're going to have Dagny. Dagny, are you back?
I'm back in.
We're going to have, great, Dagny, sorry you lost connection. But what I'd like for you to do is go ahead and introduce your business model and tell us how your business works to tame takeout trash.
Sure. Hi, everybody. Great to be here with you all. And I'm happy to present. I'm going to share my screen as well so you all can see. Can everyone see our screen now?
I can see it.
All right. I'm going to give you a full screen so you can see all the way. I'm Dagny Tucker, and I'm the founder and CEO of Vessel. Vessel actually has two arms, both a nonprofit and a for-profit side. And I want to thank Crystal, first of all, for just really laying out the problem space for us and so many of the issues we faced. We actually launched in 2016 for our first pilot live in January of that year, at which time the idea was totally ludicrous. Everyone thought we were crazy and that this would never be a thing. 5 years later, we've seen a radical shift in the landscape, but if we have time, I'll refer back to the fact that on our poll, we had a lot of interest from consumers, but you saw that the business landscape, nobody was from a business looking for reusables on that poll. So if we get time to chat in the extra, we can talk about that a little bit. Not to say that there hasn't been extreme interest. We had overwhelmingly a success with both customers and businesses in New York, more than we thought. And we really got after it for similar reasons, I would say to Crystal, around looking for a lever and a mechanism to support behavior change. Our real interest was in a mission to how can we get people to make a small behavior change and thus inspire them to make larger behavior changes. It's one of the reasons we're technology enabled, because as soon as somebody makes that choice to use a reusable instead of disposable, we can give them immediate feedback on the positive impact they're having. And what we see over time is a significant impact because of that real immediate feedback on what this seemingly innocuous choice it actually means to make the change. So we went and we overhauled our technology. We launched a citywide launch in Boulder, Colorado in 2018. In 2019, we won the City of Berkeley and Ecology Center's request for proposal for a city system there, launched 2019. And in 2020, we won the San Francisco Department of Environment and Upstream call as well. And we're planned for massive expansion. We do food and beverage, but have really focused on the beverage containers because we think there's a lack of proof of scale of reuse in the system. We've really wanted to take one item and shine that item out there as a plausible solution for cities, universities, businesses, independent, mostly open network, but we also do closed networks as well. So we do both the full service, which includes washing, distribution, collection, and we also do licensing, which I'm not really going to speak much about today, but it's an opportunity to work with businesses who want to run their own systems, closed loops where they can manage their own system, et cetera. As well as, like Natasha was speaking, our Reusable Systems Alliance, we work a lot to help enable others interested in doing reuse, really as a mission oriented. And for us, we have the customer path, which is they sign up online. It's free to check out a vessel. They do put in information like a credit card, or in some cases they can use like their food stamp card or other card as a hold. No charge is put in. They have 5 days to use it and then return it to any other participating location or tech-enabled street-side return kiosk. And then they repeat that process again. They get quantified self metrics and lots of opportunities for businesses to also communicate. We do not tie into people's POS unless there's a real specific request to do so through an API, which is enables us to stay outside of people's systems if needed and just operate as a standalone service. On the back end, we collect, we wash, we redistribute. We think the technology is really crucial in these situations so you can manage operations efficiently. I have a really short little video I will give you and you can get a taste of how it actually works. We'll see my Wi-Fi.
Dagny, we're not seeing a video. We're just seeing one page and hearing music.
Oh, what a bummer. Let's see. And
we may have missed your other slides too, sorry.
Did you miss other slides?
Yeah,
have you seen multiple slides?
No, just your front page.
Just the front page?
Yeah.
Okay, let me try a different way of presenting here from my desktop and see if that helps. Are you seeing a different slide now?
We're seeing a desktop, yep.
You're seeing my desktop or the slides?
We handle the hassle, you sip and style.
Oh, there we go. Okay, well, I will quickly give
there you. Are.
Unfortunately, you missed all these other slides. I wish I had known. Here you go. Here's what would have gone with
my voice. Sorry about that.
But no problem. Here we are, enabling reuse. You guys get the landscape. I think Crystal and Natasha, we're all very similar with slight differences and experiences, et cetera. But these are our two different models. And then I think that I can give you this now at this point. Are you seeing that?
Yes.
Yes. There's no sound, but we do see the video, so.
Oh, well, I'm sorry. The sound is a really jazzy tune.
But yeah, we are getting a ton of questions that are asking about logistics. So I think that was helpful to show. So thank you for sharing that, Dagny. Great.
And I will just say, there are lots of details to these systems. I saw, I think John's question, I don't know, he had a dozen questions about how these systems work. And I think all of us, could spend a lot of time going into the details. Ultimately, we've made our system free to the end user because we want to remove all the barriers. And we also charge a similar price. We charge only to the vendor. We charge 25 cents per every checkout, which if they're in a compostable mandated space, that's pretty comparable to what they would pay for their cup, their lid, the sleeve, et cetera. And we have a lot of different options that we use, again, for our technology on the licensing side, whether that's in event venues, corporate campuses. We've worked pretty extensively with quick service restaurants, as well as cities as a whole. So all the way from the municipal level down to independent vendors, we've really worked hard to find solutions that are flexible enough to meet the different types of demands of those ecosystems. And there's a lot of different needs within there and a lot of different complexities. So we really like to work with, anyone who's interested in looking at the landscape overall, figuring out what's best for them, and either using our system off the shelf, designing something that works for them using the tricks and tools that we have, or suggest somebody like Crystal's organization for other needs that they might have. So overall, we're in it for the behavior change. We see that there are a bazillion customers that are interested, 68%, I think, on the poll. The interest [S2] Absolutely. [S1] Is out there. Customers want it. They're demanding it. There were one or two others when we started, and now you have a lineup, like Crystal mentioned, 35 in our members. So the options exist. This policy is important, and your continued demand as consumers also continues to be real important. And we're all gonna be there to support you along that path to make reuse the reality.
Great, absolutely great, Dagny. Thank you so much. We do have a lot of questions. We are running low on time. So definitely continue to post your questions and hopefully you can stay. We'll go 15 minutes over as an overtime for Q&A, and our speakers, our panelists have all agreed to stay and continue to answer as many questions as possible. I will say that we are pleased that tonight we have one of the speakers who will participate in our next webinar on bringing reusable takeout container services to DC. Because he will be speaking in our next event, we would like for him to unmute himself, and this is going to be John Hansen of Paradigm One, and ask his question. And while he's doing that, I just want to introduce him. John Hansen is the owner of Paradigm One, and that's a reusable takeout container service in Tacoma Park with plans to expand into the DMV region.
Yes, hi. Yeah, thank you very much. And congratulations to all of you. Hi. Congratulations to all of you. I mean, it's really amazing. And, you know, we just commercially launched our reusable container program here in DC in the Tacoma Park, where we'll be servicing the whole DC metro area. I know what it takes. It's tough. It's really, really tough. Somebody just mentioned complexities. It's super complex. What business model do you do? How do you do the infrastructure? What tech do you use? All those different kinds of things. And, you know, how do you change the behavior? So I just really want to, you know, take my hat off to everyone. I'm not wearing a hat, but I'm taking it off to all of you, you know, for the great work that you're doing. It's critical. And I had a list of questions that I put up there, and, you know, a lot of it was really about the challenges, and I was getting into the weeds. But I think one of the most interesting things, thinking about all the different people who are on the call, how did you identify your business model? Because we've looked at per use fees and not charging and, memberships and all. We've ultimately settled on a membership and have tried to find the most flexible ways to do it that incentivize both the restaurant and also the consumers, knowing that you're not going to get everybody. So, you know, maybe you can talk to a little bit about the challenges that you dealt with on what is the business model you'll settle in on.
Go ahead and go first, Dagny, if you want.
I'm happy to go either way. I mean, I think that I don't think anyone has determined the best business model yet. If you want to see reuse at scale, I mean, the closest thing we probably have is a German company. The Germans, Recup, probably have more scale. They use a deposit model. They're also in Germany, which culturally I would say is pretty radically different than the US. I can say that we chose our model because we wanted zero barriers to entry. We're in it for the behavior change side of it. And we thought that if we could get the lowest barriers to entry, then we'd have the most success. I don't want sustainability, I'm preaching to the choir. And I think this webinar, we have people who want it. How can we get the people? How can we make it beautiful and accessible? So people who don't actually care are going to use it too. So that was our impetus for making the decision.
We started designing our program in 2016, and we invited all kinds of stakeholders to the table. Everyone from little old ladies to Uber drivers to chefs, government folks, and especially restaurant owners. They were such an important stakeholder as we designed this. And we, of course, were considering, oh, of course, we'll do like a deposit return or a token system or something like that. We considered all the various ways to do it. But when we talked to the restaurants, which at the beginning, and I know you'll know what I'm talking about, John, at the beginning, you need the restaurants more than they need you. And so we were listening closely to what the restaurants needed. And they said, heck no, we do not want to deal with the accounting of deposit return. And so we laid out several options, and really to get started, I mean, that's the thing. I mean, Natasha, Dagny, John, all of us will agree this is not a business model that's existed before. All of us are inventing something entirely new, and nobody's hit upon the correct business model. And that's because we're not only inventing a reuse system, we're reinventing the way society works. So, you know, we should all give ourselves a break for that. We ended up going with the subscription model because obviously that everything would be done through the app. All the impetus would be on the customer to do the behavior that needed to be done. And it didn't make any extra work for the restaurant. And now, you know, 3-4 years into it, we've learned so much. And, you know, we're working on moving away from the subscription model and doing it through transactional fees. People always say, oh, well, why don't you just charge a little extra and then return it at the end or give prizes or discounts? Well, luckily, you can do that through software. And there's obviously a phenomenon occurring right now, which is the global pandemic, which means a lot more people are ordering online. So I think the key, and I bet everyone here will agree, the key is associating a container with a person, very important for the accountability. And that can also be done with integrating through POS systems, existing POS systems. It's a thing, it's the future, mark my words. And that will allow us to have a different business model as well.
I just want to add to that, like what we're experiencing now in this brand new market, the solution is going to be different now for companies that are just getting into it. They're probably going to wear more hats than they will later. So I think down the road, we might see companies that specialize in the different areas, right? Like one does design and manufacturing of the containers themselves. Maybe one does the technology and the inventory tracking, and then later another one does sanitation. I don't know if necessarily the company that kind of, or the group of companies that end up taking over the world, if you want to put it that way, will end up doing all of those things.
Okay, thank you ladies for that answer. I mean, it's a lot. We have to start somewhere. So that's what makes it so exciting to see how you guys have started and you're up and you're operating and you have these ideas and you're just moving forward. John, thank you so much for asking the question. And I definitely look forward to seeing you on the next webinar as a panelist. So we have another participant here today, Rachel Clark of Council Member Chase office. She was part of the development of the DC Zero Waste Omnibus Amendment Act that became law on March 16th. I would like to have Rachel, if she could unmute herself and ask her question. We could take that at this time.
Hi, I'm gonna stay off video because I have kids around, but I actually put my question in the chat. I was curious how you all have worked with your local governments in setting up your businesses. I think Dagny answered the question a little bit. She said, did you receive grant funding or that kind of financial support? And then if you could talk more specifically about the other type of support you got.
Anyway.
I can go first. So we are a nonprofit. We wanted to do this reusable takeout container service, but we had no money at all. So we did the thing that many entrepreneurs do, which is we use crowdfunding, we use Kickstarter, which I don't actually recommend because you'll have a heart attack while doing it. It's extremely stressful. If you don't raise your entire amount, you won't get anything. So you have to reach this certain amount by a certain deadline. And I'm sure that I took away many years of my life, but it does one thing very well. Kickstarter basically helps validate your idea, right? So if you say, I'm gonna start a reusable takeout container service in your town and 1,000 people give you $20, let's say, well, you already have 1,000 supporters, and it's pretty much a vote of confidence that that's something the community wants. So, you know, I think entrepreneurs are very creative in their funding. If they're a for-profit company, they'll try to pitch their idea and get some investment, maybe some angel donors. We just went with Kickstarter and started real scrappy-like. And one of the best partnerships has been the health department, because, you know, we didn't want to, you never want to blindside your health department. It's a very bad idea. And so we did a really smart thing, which we did by accident. Really, we just started inviting them to our meetings like 2 years before we even started the program and asked them to help us design it. And that way they feel like it's their program as well, like our shared program. So that's really nice. Maybe Natasha and Dagny have more hopeful answers than I do, but I have been working hard on angling us as part of any good city's solid waste management plan. I mean, I think probably everybody's municipality is the same. You've got sustainability goals for the city, right? You got strategic plans, and well, some of them are about reducing waste. And why not make something like our program a part of just like trash and recycling? So I haven't been successful yet, but hopefully Natasha and Dagny can speak more to that.
Yeah, so I was actually incredibly inspired by Crystal's program. So thank you for putting some of that online for me. I will say this, the reason that we have our restaurants sanitized and we did pilot doing it ourselves is that our Minnesota food code, and I'm in Minneapolis, I saw that someone asked, our food code does not allow for us to sanitize offsite and then deliver the containers to the restaurants without them having to re-sanitize them. So we are working with the health department and the county to modify the legislation. They do it every, the state does it every 4 years. So that is something that we're working on. We are a for-profit, but we have received $50,000 in grants so far, and there are more. We're lucky just that they're available in our county. I would also say like startup accelerators are really desirable if you can find those in your area. Those are good sources for finding money as well. But yeah, I'll just kind of leave it at that.
I will say for us, it's been really interesting, the relationship with governments and funding in general. And I would say again, it was impossible to get investment funding in this space early on. There was just nobody doing it. And I think that for us, the first sort of wasn't exactly municipal, because while it was for the city of Berkeley and had city of Berkeley backing, that funding was actually raised by the Ecology Center from Berkeley, which handles their hauling. That's the official recycling hauler for the city. But it was sort of the first request for proposals that we saw in North America. And that was huge. That was a huge demarcator. And so to the question of is government funding and like, is that happening or is it important? We have definitely looked for that funding and we're just starting to see it come out. And I think it makes all the difference in the world. You're talking about a landscape in which I propose that nobody necessarily believes reuse at scale is going to work yet. I think there are question marks out there for that, but it's the chicken and the egg. You got to have the funding and the money to scale something to understand its viability. And I think governments can play a tremendous role, not only obviously in looking at policy that's going to support that. Berkeley had policy. In order to pass that policy, they needed viable solutions as alternatives. That's why they came up with the funding. They put in a policy of a required 25-cent fee to consumers if they took a reusable and mandated that restaurants have a reusable option available. In order to pass that, they needed a reusable service provider, right? That makes a huge difference. So we always actively engage the health department. I could go on forever. Crystal, super smart to engage them early. Also an important, a crucial player. And I will say we've worked with the FDA. It answers a question that came up about reusables. We've worked directly with the CDC and FDA this year. There is no national policy, so it makes it very onerous for local policy to manage the health department side of things. Everybody has to make the decision on their own regionally based on their own codes. It has been the introduction of reusable policy that was supposed to be introduced last year. It was delayed at the food safety conference and because of COVID, and it will be introduced this year. the policy wasn't delayed, the conference was delayed as a whole. So that reuse policy will come up this year. I think that's enough. We have lots of questions. So.
Yes, as you know, tonight's event has been organized by the DC chapter of the Sierra Club, more specifically the Zero Waste Committee, which focuses on ways to reduce waste in DC. If you're interested in joining the DC chapter of the Sierra Club, please contact us at zero.waste@dc.sierraclub.org or check us out at our website, dc.sierraclub.org, where you will find links to join and donate to our work. And these are also going to be posted in the chat, so you can reference those. Due to time, we're going to skip round two because you guys are clearly engaged and there's a ton of questions coming in, and we just want to make sure we can answer some additional questions. Reminding you guys, just go ahead and post your questions in the chat. We have a few more minutes, looks like maybe 5 more minutes, so hopefully we can do maybe 1 or 2 questions. And our speakers have all agreed to stay. So let's just look to see. Wow, okay, there's a lot of questions here. let's see. There's a lot of questions about logistics, but there's also a few very specific questions that I don't think we touched on. So this is a quick question. What's done with utensils? Or is there going to be any work done around utensils?
Yeah, I would encourage, I'm sure many people on here are all obviously preaching to the choir. So it's probably a lot of folks who are similar to us. If you're not already part of the National Reuse Network through Upstream, I'd suggest getting on at least the listserv, if not coming to the meetings. It's really kind of like a national clearinghouse for model legislation and innovative things happening. And what they're trying to do is replicate these things and harmonize language and a lot of important things for the reuse movement. But I bring that up because one of the really cool campaigns right now is called Skip the Stuff. And it's not just a campaign to get people to raise awareness about single-use cutlery, but it's also some actions that are being taken, like creation of model legislation to make sure that those things are opt-in only, not just by default put in your bag every time you order takeout. We just did some research in Durham. It's not published yet, we're working on publishing it, but it was a 576 respondent survey to find out. We really felt there's a disconnect between what customers actually want and what restaurants think you want. And so we wanted to show restaurants the results of our survey. What do customers actually do with the disposable cutlery? Of course, we all know those usually end up in a kitchen drawer until, because you feel guilty, and then later you're like, I gotta clean this drawer, and so you throw them all away, or you find some kind of art project, but that's not sustainable. So the majority of the respondents never use them. And so when we publish this and have the numbers available, we wanna be able to show the restaurants in our in the area where the survey was taken, that look, you could save so much money. So I think there's different angles. You as a customer can say, don't give me that stuff. You can type that into your online order. You can just shout it 3 times into the phone, whatever. You can also join the National Reuse Network, keep your eyes open for the model legislation. And you can influence restaurants by, you know, if someone speaks up and says, can you just try to only have this available if people ask and see what happens? Because in other places, customers really don't want this stuff. I think there's a lot that can be done.
Thank you, Crystal. Thanks for that. And yes, that's a pain for me. I don't even want to get into it. I asked them not to give me utensils, and they always give me utensils.
We have a question. Show us your drawers, and made people aware of their kitchen drawers.
I have like, it won't even fit in a drawer. I have like an over, it's just so many. So Steve Pratt, he's on and he has asked, have there been any logistical issues imposed by COVID related restrictions? Many businesses have stopped using reusables even in house. And I've observed this as well. Does anyone want to give their thoughts on how COVID has impacted? And I know there's definitely going to be some longer term impacts related to COVID-19. Dagny, would you like to?
I'm happy to speak to that just a little bit. Yeah, obviously. I mean, what hasn't COVID impacted at this point? And I would say, you know, a couple of things. From an operator's standpoint, live in multiple cities at that point, we actually have had really close reworking relationships with our health departments, and we got a green light from all of our health departments to keep operating. And we actually saw an increase in demand on the early side of COVID because our businesses no longer wanted the liability of having dishware, and we took over that liability essentially. So we were a real value offering to them at that point. And we saw continued and in fact, increased use in consumer checkouts as well. That said, the many of our restaurants, particularly in California, we work on the UC Berkeley campus, the Cal campus there, and a lot of restaurants just closed, right? I think the bigger picture, I would say, is some of the work that we've been trying to do with the CDC and other national legislative bodies, but obviously the CDC became the real public voice during this crisis, more so even than for consumers, more so than obviously the health department really. And even for businesses needing to feel like they were following CDC recommendations. The CDC still has language out that suggests your first most, your safest option is to use single-use disposables first. What we have done to that end is really submitted protocols, and we had to change some procedural protocols around the washing and distribution. Not any of the washing, because that was already certified, but certainly how our employees handle, how the checkouts are handled. You can't have any contact. We used to have a checkout that was handled by the customer, and then the cup was handed over, completely removing any of those contact points. Our tech-enabled return kiosks also, there were new standards on collection of those returned containers. All of that were protocols that we've worked on really, really to try and get the CDC to change their language, to be honest. But also things that we wanted the safety for our workers more than anyone else. It's obviously, it's impacted the space, it's impacted perception. I think perception is the biggest problem. And I think that we see that in many arenas in our country around science and perception. And we know contact isn't really a problem anymore. We have tons of scientists. There's plenty of evidence that reusables are safe. And in fact, we've sent, both to the FDA and CDC working conversation that you can actually have a reduced number of contact points with reusables over disposables. So yeah, I could talk all night about this.
That's great. And we are at time, ladies. This has been a wonderful conversation, a starter conversation, because I feel like there's so much more that I want to learn personally. And I think I can tell by the chat that there's a lot of questions still out there, and it's a lot of enthusiasm. I want to give each of you like 30 seconds. Do you have any final thoughts or last thoughts, or if there's any point that you think would be important to make while we have your time now? I'll start with Crystal.
Yeah, I think it sounds like the majority of the folks in the audience are citizens who haven't used a reuse program yet and don't necessarily operate one or want to start one. But I think the best thing, I mean, I think it was Jane Fonda. She's an activist, as we know. Jane Fonda said something really cool recently. She was asked, like, what is the single best thing that people can do to make change? And you'd think she'd say something profound like, go do this right now. But really what she said was, join a group that's doing the thing that you think ought to be done. Because it's when we're together that we're really the most powerful. So John and anyone else who's operating a reuse program, I say come and join the Reuse Systems Alliance with us. Don't make all the same mistakes that we made or reinvent the wheel. Like, we can help you out. And then for folks who are like really interested in the policy, join the National Reuse Network, find a chapter of your local Sierra Club, get on board with Zero Waste and see what you can contribute.
Thank you, Crystal. Everyone on the call, I think we put in a lot of links, and hopefully there'll be a link for the National Reuse Network, definitely the Sierra Club Zero Waste Committee. I'm a volunteer, so you can come hang out with me. Let's do Dagny. Can you, 30 seconds, last thought?
Sure. Crystal, just reiterating everything she said, and I think that's absolutely right. I mean, we could field probably 10 hours a week of people looking at starting reuse systems. So like I said, it went from 0 to 100 or 1,000 very quickly, which is our mission. So our nonprofit side is exceptionally interested in seeing reuse expand and grow and be successful. If one of us floats, we all float. We, this, you know, raising ships all together. So like Crystal said, RSA, but also feel free to reach out to us directly. We'll try and get you whatever resources we can and try and help you through any pitfalls. Municipalities, governments, universities, everyone else, same goes for you. We're happy to sort of help direct and share the landscape of what's out there and try and get you the best solution to solve your needs.
Thank you, Dagny. And I love that attitude that all of you have about sharing. There's no in this together, and it's just if we just have to move the needle just a little bit, just one at a time, that's going to be how things progress. Natasha, 30 seconds, last thought.
Just one final thought here. For those of you that think that your small actions don't matter, they absolutely do. You ask your server at your restaurant not to give you a straw, and you think, oh, well, this is one straw and like an ocean full of straws. Well, you haven't just impacted yourself. You have impacted the server. You've impacted maybe the people that are sitting with you there at the table. The straw movement has become this huge campaign. Lonely Whale actually kicked it off or added to it. And it's called the Stop Sucking campaign. Like, these little actions and things that you do in life, people are noticing. It's everyone around you. So don't guilt people. Just let them know what you're doing and how it makes you feel, and be very kind to people in those moments when they're naive and they don't know. Just be kind and let them know, hey, here's something I tried. Maybe you'd like to try it too, and keep doing those little actions.
Thank you for that, Natasha. Because yeah, sometimes you kind of get overwhelming when you have things in your head and you're just like, I'm just not doing enough. But it's great to know that, you know, your one action, I mean, it does make a difference, and that's important to remember. So thanks again to all of our panelists, Crystal, Dagny, Natasha. Thanks to all the participants for being here and asking questions and being engaged and networking in the chat. We hope that you all had an opportunity to learn and network. We look forward to seeing some new reusable takeout container services coming to DC in the near future. We'll be in touch about our future events. Stay tuned. Thanks again. We hope that you will join us for our next webinar on bringing reusable takeout container services to DC. Please follow us at Zero Waste DCSC on Twitter. And thanks again. I'm going to let you guys sign off. So hopefully we'll see you at our next event. Bye, everyone. Thank you. And oh, special shout out to the Sierra Club. Thanks for hosting this.